much. Thank you. Kind of apropos to have my theme song playing there. For those who aren't familiar with that, that's the great Scott Henderson. No? He's like stone-faced over there. Dude, turn it off already, please. That's the theme music. That's the opening bumper to my radio show, The No State Project. How many people here are intimately familiar with The No State Project radio show? Yeah, don't pan the camera around. That would be brutal. Well, I'm glad to have new people watching, listening, and checking out the material. I appreciate everyone getting up this early in the morning, especially this guy. It looks like you had a good night last night. So, the radio show, The No State Project. This is actually the new banner. And I just want to point out that I'm not an anarcho-syndicalist or communist. I just like the colors. So, but the No State Project, we do it live every Saturday from 4 to 7 Eastern Standard Time. We're going to be doing it in the, right next to the Brittany room, the Ascot. I think it's the Ascot room. It's just on Ascot. So we're not going to be able to cover all the ground here, because just like on a radio show, I always run out of time. But we will continue. So if there's anybody here, especially if you're not familiar with the No State Project, if you're a minarchist or you still have any kind of belief in governments, citizens, and voting and stuff like that, if you're not cured of that by the end of this talk, when we've got the radio show that we'll be doing. And big shout out to Calvin, of course, who's working the cameras and always with the post-production. You'll be in front of the camera for the show. And then we've got non-entity, of course. Oh, I didn't get the full look of death, but who's also helping with the cameras. We'll edit that part out of the broadcast. So, well, what I look to do on the No State Project, hey, we were in Phoenix. We had lunch with Bill Buford. Yeah, good to have you back. You are one of the a former police officer. See, I never forget when someone says they're a former police officer. So glad to see you back. What we try to do is get to a volunteer society, just one show at a time. We're not looking to have the radio show be the biggest and baddest broadcast in the world, but what we do on the show and we accomplish is bringing people to an understanding that there is no government, there are no states, there are no citizens, and give them the tools necessary that if they're going to stop paying taxes, which a lot of people who have listened to the show have emailed me, yes, they're going to use some discretion there, of course, you can understand, but a lot of people over the years we've been doing the show have stopped paying taxes, which is really one of the biggest goals of the show. Yes, we want to get to a voluntary society, but one of the ways to get there is to stop complying with the tax code, stop allowing them to farm us. And that is one of the main goals. Getting traffic tickets thrown out is great. If you go to markstevens.net, we had 3 thrown out this week. It's not the main purpose of the show. It's not the main purpose of what I do. It's a nice benefit because there's more people who are being, you know, activist-minded and are not complying. They're not paying taxes. They're not getting driver's licenses. They're not doing these things. They're not complying. And so they're getting the tools necessary through the show, on the website, and of course the book is, yes, and the book is released. We have the actual cover, thanks to Brian, who helped with the cover. So why don't we give a big shout out and applause for Brian for helping with the sandcastle. Because if you saw the previous sandcastles that I did, and what it was the word government as a sandcastle, because the theme of the book and the theme of the show, and I think what we're doing at Libertopia, is that the concept of government is itself a castle made of sand. And so when you see on the back of the book, it's all been wiped out. This beautiful, yes. This is actually a copy, so you can see the castle made of sand. And then, of course, on the back, it is anarchy approved when it has washed away. And so the purpose of the show and what I'm going to be talking about today, about activism, journalism, is to prove that it is a castle made of sand. The concept of government, completely nonsensical, makes absolutely no logical sense. Any serious study into the concept of government itself will reveal to even the most hardened statist that it's contradictory. And I wrote in the book, and I know, so I'm saying, well, if it's that simple, then I wrote in the book that the concept of government, the whole idea of it, is provably false because the means are not consistent with the end, that lying, stealing, and killing people is not consistent with protecting people from lying, stealing, and killing. And that, well, why the hell is the book 4 inches thick then? Well, it's very difficult to break people of their conditioning. And we have some calls that we're going to get to in a little while that's going to prove that. It's very difficult to break people that. So is there anybody here who actually believes that there are citizens and states and governments? Wow, you do? You believe that there are actually governments and states? You have a government. Are you sure about that? Okay, but does that prove that there's a government? Okay. Well, government is always clearly defined as a group of men and women that are acting on behalf of a state. Otherwise, they're just a gang of killers, thieves, and liars, right? What? It's crime syndicate. Well, yes, that's a more accurate description of them. But their whole basis of being able to do what they do, their moral authority, which is the only reason why people really pay them, except also out of fear, is that they believe and people believe that they are different, that they're not just human beings, that they're government, and that they have this thing called the law that separates them. That it's not just a logical fallacy called a double standard or a special pleading that the rules don't apply to them. It's because they have a right to steal, kill, cheat, and lie to us. They have a right to do that. They have a moral right to do that. And when we go through and we'll examine this, completely fallacious. There's absolutely no truth to that at all. But it's very difficult even for liberty activists to really get their mind around and grasp these things that they call laws and constitutions don't apply to anybody. And it's one thing for us to discuss that here in this setting. It is really a different story when you're actually engaging these people. And they're corporate psychopaths, to put it gently. And I say psychopath or sociopath, and I always mention on the show why. Because you're talking about certain behavior, and that behavior is a compulsion to lie and to control other people, no empathy, a callous disregard for others, and a massive, massive ego that sociopaths and psychopaths, or narcissists in general, don't tolerate being questioned well at all. So if anyone ever go to court, and yes, I mean, we know. So if you've been to court, you notice that most, at least in my experience, when you question the prosecutor, you question the judge, especially the judge, do they handle it well most of the time? No. They usually start yelling and screaming. And you've had a bit of experience with that. And they go from being calm and rational to on a split second, they've completely changed and they're raging. It's like a 5-year-old, and since he doesn't have a gun to just shoot you like a cop would, all he can do is yelling and scream and start yelling about contempt, and or if you don't like it, you can appeal it, that kind of stuff. But I believe that through our efforts and being journalists, and what is a journalist? I know that they like to tell you that a journalist is somebody who works for CNBC or somebody who works for CNN or one of the major things. That's one of the things that they've hit me with. I went and I was stalked by Mesa PD because we're going to listen to some of these calls in a little bit, but I had a stupid moment and I decided to take my camera as a journalist, because a journalist is just someone who reports the truth, especially when that truth undermines a hierarchy that support, you know, that we live under. So if you do anything journalist-wise and you're bringing forth evidence, which is what I'll show you, and you're bringing forth evidence that goes against the established hierarchy, it's not going to go very far. And they're going to, well, one, we have on the radio show, on the website, when I had Colby Granville from the Tempe City Council, this is HD video. He was up for election. He got reelected, and I have HD video of him saying, you want evidence that our laws, our evidence of jurisdiction is because we said so. I'm thinking, wow. And I was able to prove, it's on the website, look under the call of shames on the markstevens.net. I went to every major news outlet in Phoenix, Arizona. Now, I didn't post all that on the website, but I posted what I thought was the most important damning part of it. And that was the editorial news, the guy who did the, who ran the news department for, I think it's Channel 12 News in Phoenix. He wouldn't even look at the video. It's like 4 minutes long. You have a sitting politician wanting to be reelected saying we have jurisdiction because we said so. Nothing. And why don't they put that in there? Because it goes against the established order. They cannot prove that their laws apply. So what I brought up to them was a very simple thing. And this is also in video. And I've done it with Scottsdale, but they got some stupid rule that they just have to sit there like, you know, the monkeys. They don't have to say anything. You just get up there and rant. So it's better to do with places where they will actually engage you. And I lost my train. Well, I was in Mesa, but I was in Tempe, but that's where they weren't able to answer the questions because they are not able to prove that their laws apply. So the simple thing, what I'm bringing out, it's not just a matter that they can't prove that their laws apply. You're talking about when you go into court, their entire premise is based on one single argument, and it doesn't matter where you are physically, one single argument covers all their violence, and that's what everyone believes in. And it's this, if you are physically in California, then the constitutional laws apply to you, right? Isn't that why a cop stops you? That's his argument, though. His argument in his head is evidence their entire body of law has any application at all. It's not relevant. So what we do is it's a logical progression. But to get back, the reason why it was so damaging, why nobody would pick this up, is the question that I posed to them, where are your judges getting this evidence to prove jurisdiction to take control and actually have a trial in the first place? If your cops don't have it, if you don't have it, and I've already been to your city attorney, they don't have it, we submitted it to the entire prosecuting staff in Tempe. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. The police chief refused to speak to me on advice of counsel who wouldn't give me the information either. So for all these so-called code violations, where are the judges getting the evidence to prove the laws apply if they're not getting it from the cops? So I was able to show, and yes, I have, my microphone wasn't on, I have Bruce Washburn, Scottsdale city attorney, advising the treasurer, who's in charge of the risk management, not to investigate charges of collusion. Because if the judges don't have the evidence, and they know they don't have the evidence, that the cops don't have, what are they doing? It's got to be collusion, right? They're working together. Where the heck is this evidence that they're supposed to have? And then, of course, you throw in, the judge is supposed to presume you innocent, right? How is he presuming you innocent and presuming or assuming for the prosecution that the laws apply to you? There's no presumption of innocence. So I get it transcribed from someone who reads lips, but I had HD video with Scott Washburn telling the treasurer not to investigate charges of collusion. That's called insurance fraud, but they don't care. And because we don't really have much remedy with these people, I believe this is why it is so important for us as journalists, to act as journalists, to be journalist activists, to go and confront these people. Because if you're interested in freedom, if you're interested in personal autonomy, at some point, if you live your principle to any degree, you're going to be subject to an attack at some point. So I think it behooves us to be prepared to be able to engage these people. And know, like I've said for 15 years now, to engage in effective damage control, because once they set their sights on you, you are going to be damaged and hurt to some degree. Even if you get it tossed out like these three guys did this week. It took time, it took energy, and so I believe by acting as a journalist, which is just anybody with a camera or investigating, and is putting the information out there. It doesn't matter if you're not on CNBC. It doesn't matter. That's why you'll see some, like in Phoenix, where even if it gets into the mainstream somehow, they always have to put down, oh, it's an internet show, as if the method of broadcast has anything to do with the facts that you're presenting. You know, that whole it's just an internet thing. Well, why don't you look at the evidence first and make up your mind? But these people aren't interested in evidence. So when I talk to people about this stuff, especially when they've come to me and they've got problems with taxes or drugs, possession, or, you know, some other silly code violation, they'll usually have a problem still because they haven't listened to the show or read the book. I know, who would have thought, but they still have a problem wrapping their mind around that there's no evidence that these laws apply. But I'm here in California. Okay. And then you run them through. And so I tell them, just because you are not able to prove that the Constitution and Code applies just because you're physically in California, don't think that they're any better. I've had people on the phone with me with an IRS call who were still skeptics. And it wasn't until the agent admits, and we have this, we'll have a call of shame here, with the IRS agent actually admitting to not being able to prove that the laws apply. Who said that? You did. See, Cynthia, there's over 9,000 examples of this on the website, by the way. This is just one of, like, hundreds and hundreds of calls. I have one here in California from years ago, a guy named Daniel with the Franchise Tax Board. After first saying that they had to have evidence to support the assessment, when he admittedly had none, laughs at me. We don't need evidence. See, I could believe that, but you already said that you needed that. So contradicting yourself there pretty bad. But some people have had to be on the line with me and hear the IRS actually say that themselves before they said, oh, my gosh, you're right. They can't prove that. Now, I do want to take a little disclaimer here. The fact that someone who works for the IRS, or like you'll hear, Nick Court, who is a deputy attorney general in New Hampshire, the man's job is to argue in front of the Supreme Court. You will hear him not be able to produce a single fact, not yet, a single fact that the laws that he enforces people to comply with every day apply to anyone. Okay? But I believe that, you know, yes, we should be healthy skeptics, you know, skeptical with an open mind, let the evidence speak for itself. But the fact that Nick Court, even though he's a deputy attorney general, which doesn't mean anything to me, but it means something to critics who think that I don't know what I'm talking about. Well, you're just some schmuck from Long Island. He's the attorney general. Okay, shouldn't he have been able to answer the questions? Well, it's a stupid question. Stupid question. These people don't have any evidence, and it's not the proof that there's no evidence that their constitutional laws apply is not just because they can't provide it. That's not what I'm saying, okay? That would be another logical fallacy. Just because Joe Sixpack over here can't doesn't mean there isn't evidence, okay? That's one of the main criticisms. Well, just because he didn't, you got him on a bad day. I've actually been accused of just getting lucky. Or I just get stupid agents. Like, oh, so the agent was stupid. So, okay, so you can answer the question. And I've also been accused of cherry picking, that I don't provide the calls where they actually do provide the evidence. Not something I can really prove other than laying out 8 gigs worth of... if with something like that, I just put the onus on the burden on the one making the accusation. If you think I'm cherry picking, you go and ask the agents. You ask them, why don't you come on my radio show? You present the evidence that they couldn't, because there is none. So, and the reason why, And I recommend, we're not going to listen to this call today, but I recommend going to my website and reading and watching the video with Jerry Cobb, and it's called Mountain of Evidence or More Logical Fallacies. Because he goes through a lot of these and I address a lot of those issues. And what he does there, he admits the obvious. Well, how do we know that there's no evidence the Constitution or Code apply to anyone just because we're physically in Arizona? Well, just like Jerry Cobb admitted, and Lysander Spooner points out, the Constitution and their laws are just written instruments. And it's like the social contract. Social contract? Man, I didn't sign shit. The facts that you put together is you've got a written instrument and all support is compulsory. No one agreed. So, before I'm out of time, well, we've got time. So, I understand and I expect that people are going to be a little bit skeptical about that. But the proof is in the evidence. We let the evidence do the talking. If someone thinks, and this is why I have a standing challenge, thanks to my boy here, $5,000 that Paul, and we all know Paul here, he's a stand-up guy, $5,000 for anybody who can produce a single fact to support the argument that if you're physically in Arizona or New Hampshire or California, that the laws apply to you. $5,000, no one will touch it. And I do have to make a disclaimer. Unlike what some people have said, this is absolutely nothing to do with the freeman on the land, sovereign citizen garbage. This is pure anarchy from a standpoint like Lysander Spooner. We're looking at the evidence. We're not making political judgments. We're not making political statements. We're looking at the evidence. You've got a written instrument here, and you're willing to kill me to get me to pay for your product. That tells me it's got nothing to do with the written instrument, everything to do with the gun. So when people go into court, it's a very stressful thing. And you're asking these questions, and they're going to use logical fallacies and, of course, gaslighting techniques. I go through all the techniques used against you in the book. And one of them is, are you seriously contending or arguing that the laws don't apply to you? Is that really what you're saying? Just to make you feel stupid. And I always come back and say, no, what I'm asking you is for evidence to support that argument. Do you have it, yes or no? Ah, you're an idiot. That may be, but that doesn't answer the question. Okay? Doesn't answer the question. So I believe that we can help ourselves and others, because we also have media reps that are people usually willing to go to court and let the judge know that you're there as a media rep. You're there from the media as doing shows on judicial misconduct, a series of shows on judicial misconduct. We want the judge to know out of courtesy. And they tend not to yell and scream, not always, but it tends to put them on better behavior. And because it's so stressful when you do go into court, I believe we can use activism in a number of different ways as journalists to not only get out there that these people are killers, thieves, and liars, and okay, but by engaging them outside of court where the chances of them yelling and screaming when they're being recorded are very, very low. So your chances of – your risk of going to jail is very low. That's why I do the parking ticket study. And it gives a number of psychopaths some great pleasure to say, ha, parking tickets, there's a lot of big issues raised there. You're raising the same issue. It's the same argument. The parking ticket rests on exactly the same argument as does a tax evasion charge. You're physically in the United States. Our constitutional laws apply to you. We have jurisdiction. You are our bitch. That's it. So it doesn't matter what the actual charge is. It's the same underlying arguments. So attack them. And by attack, I just mean asking questions. You always have to give that. When you say collateral attack, it doesn't mean you're picking up a gun. It means you're just asking questions and you're challenging them. And by engaging them at city council meetings, you can also get contact with the police chief. So through that, but I didn't actually put it there because it is kind of a long one. It's 10 minutes long. So we may have to save that and we'll see how it goes. But the city manager had to intervene, I should say, and tell he had already admitted to me he couldn't prove the laws apply to anybody. Anybody. Imagine the city manager, his job in Scottsdale is to enforce the edicts of politicians against several tens of thousands of people. What, 100,000 people live in Scottsdale or 200,000? That's his job. And he didn't flinch. Could you imagine destroying the lives or just enforcing yourself into the lives of 100,000 people and not having an ounce of guilt, nothing, no shame, nothing, when you can't even answer a question that do your laws, you know, what evidence you have your laws apply? Nothing. Nothing. So that's why I said it's a callous disregard for others. He wasn't like a cop wanting to beat the hell out of me, but he didn't flinch. He still went to work the next day. But anyway, he intervened and had the Alan Rodbell agree to at least a 5-minute interview with me on the phone. It took 6 months to get that set up because the police department ran interference, which is why I did that stupid thing going into Mesa PD. They said if you were a real journalist, you would have known not to just walk into a police station with a camera. You would have went through our public information officer. Oh, you see, because I'm a real journalist, I know from experience the PIO runs interference. That's what they did in Scottsdale. If you call the PIO, you're going nowhere. So that's one of the things I want to put out there, that when you're doing this, when you want to engage them, don't go to the public information officer. Okay, I've got on the website where they've hung up on me. Their job is to make the agency look good. Do you think they're going to let you talk to any of their bosses, the capo? They're not going to let you talk to the capos. Their job is to run interference. So if you're going to do this, and you're not just going to the city council meetings, which I highly recommend, make sure it's a city or council or it is a county commission where they answer questions. Don't just go to like Scottsdale and say your piece. Unless you then use that opportunity before or after to just walk up to the politician, which we don't usually get to do. It's not like New Hampshire. Dave Ridley, you're killing me. You're killing me. You're killing me, Dave. I never had that opportunity to just always walk. I've had it a few times, just walk up with a camera like you can in New Hampshire. Not so much in Phoenix and definitely not down here. But don't go through the PIO. If you're doing it on the phone and they want you to do that, if they tell you to give them the questions first, don't do it. Do not give them the questions. You will not ever get a response from them. It's not going to happen. Not going to happen. And if you get your way in, like what I did with Jerry Cobb, you have to make absolutely certain that the response, at least he's confirming, it's not from him. It's like I did with the county attorney in Phoenix, a guy named, what is it, Montgomery. And I had him confirm on the phone and in an email that it was written by the county attorney in part, and he signed off and agreed with the whole thing. It's pure garbage. And, of course, Jerry Cobb, mountain of evidence, or logical fallacy. But when we go in there and engage them with asking these questions, and you can see video of me doing this, and we'll have some audio, knowing that there's very little risk, you can confidently go in there and just put them on the spot. But we'll go through this also, you have to remember, just like in court, they're going to spin things, they're going to misdirect, they can do everything but answer the damn question. So it's very, very important that we come in knowing our logical fallacies. I'm not saying take a 5-year course and get a degree in logic. We don't need that. But the basic principles of logic we need to understand and know the techniques that these people use. One of the biggest ones is, of course, circular logic. Another one is, of course, gaslighting, which isn't really a fallacy, but they'll create a straw man. Does everyone here know what a straw man is? Oh, this is a good group. A very common one, and this goes through, it doesn't matter if it's state, local, federal, whatever. It doesn't matter what agency it is. You'll ask them a pointed question on evidence. So one of the important things we do, and I always call like the Socratic method, we're just asking questions. You get agreement first with their argument. And their argument is, if you're physically in Arizona, then the Constitution laws apply. Get agreement to that first. Then you can start engaging and asking the questions. And you always want to keep going back and having them confirm that that is their position. Because what are they going to do later when they get into trouble? That's not what I said. The hell it's not. I wrote it down. I'm recording. Tell me exactly what is your position then. So you can still go back. But remember, you're asking questions. They're the ones making the argument. We're the ones trying to debunk it. We have no business making an affirmative statement. You're just asking questions. And that's one of the big things here. When you're engaging these people, treat it like a cross-examination, like you're in court. All your questions will be leading questions. Now, does everyone know what a leading question is? A leading question has the answer in the question. So an example would be, on the night of November 5th, did you go, on the night of October 5th, you went to Libertopia? So it's maybe not the best example of a leading question, but it is a leading question.
Yeah. On November 5th, after you left Libertopia, did you go to that liquor store?
There you go. Did you go to that liquor store?
Right.
It's also a compound question, depending on what the previous question was. So keep that in mind. Every time someone calls me or calls into the show, and they were asking these questions, and they are very simple, right? I mean, these are very simple questions. It's a very rational approach to destroying an argument. One second. The point that they got where they choked, where they screwed up, was to violate the rule, don't take an affirmative position. Every time they got in trouble, usually, unless the judge was screaming, they would just freaked out, was that they took the burden off of the person they're interviewing. So that's one of the things that they like to do. And people will fall for that. To say, what evidence would satisfy you, Mark? Just answer the question. So imagine if you're a real journalist and you're calling a police agency about, or a fire department about a fire. And said, well, you've alleged that this is arson, not natural or an accident. What facts do you rely on, Mr. Fire Chief, to say that this was actually arson? What kind of proof would satisfy you? Holy crap. But you don't usually get that in typical investigations from the real media. We're going to get that. What will satisfy? And then, which leads me to another logical fallacy, the just calling you a retard.
Of course, you can answer that question. Oh, so there is evidence. Or so there is facts.
Yeah.
Because then they say, what evidence would satisfy you? Well, so there is evidence.
Do you have any? Give me that. I had a public defender actually try to rattle me because he thought that I was putting someone in prison. See, that's right, because I had the power to put people in prison. Did anyone not see that? And so he was asking me questions. And I had asked him, well, look, what evidence do you have? What evidence has the prosecution shown you to prove that there's jurisdiction? And he turned around after some other logical fallacies saying, Mark, no amount of proof is gonna convince you. I said, oh, that's right. The old Mark's a retard line. I got it. Yeah, because I'm too stupid to it. Why don't you put it on the table first? But that's a very common thing. Nothing I say will satisfy you. You're dodging the question. You haven't given me anything. Just lay out the facts. Nothing I say. So those are important things to keep in mind. Yes. Wait. We had a do we have the microphone? Yeah. We're going to sound professional on this video.
Shall I wait for the microphone?
Yeah.
Test.
Hey, there we go.
Testing. Oh, this is awesome.
Yeah, this is not a live broadcast, so we've actually got some technology going on here.
Here at the town and country, I am the law, so you guys all have to do it. I'm sorry. Okay, so your position is that we should establish with our interlocutor that their position is X. In my imagination, I'm thinking, okay, so I say, is it your position that my presence here in the state of California makes me susceptible to or subject to the laws, etc.? And they're going to answer, no, that is the way it is. That's not my position. So have I established it or not?
You have established. You've got agreement. I wouldn't phrase it that way. I used to go through and get into all the details about the state. And it's an effective way to go. But if you notice, you're not going to have much time to do this. You have maybe 4 minutes tops, especially if you're in court. You're going to be calling security if you keep going. So I always phrase it at the simplest possible way so that I cross whatever political boundaries there are and I never have to get into the business of the state. because it just saves time to do it this way. You always, I phrase it this way. Is it your position or your operating presumption, sir, that if I'm physically in California, the Constitution laws apply?
No, that's not my position. That's actually the way it is.
Okay, great. But you agree that's how you operate?
Yes.
Fantastic. Okay. And then you say, do you have any actual facts to support that argument? And then you're going to get the cascade of logical fallacies. Well, the laws say so. He's laughing, but as we're going to hear, that is an actual answer that you'll get many times. So you could come out real one second. There's one in Phoenix. This is great. This is an actual call on the website that we're not going to play today. It's just a little too long. The agent, this is a tax agent in Phoenix, and he says, well, the laws apply because they say so. Whoa. Isn't that circular logic? No. So the fact that you're starting and ending with the same proposition, that doesn't sound like logical fallacy to you? No. Let me ask you a question. If I said to you the laws don't apply because the laws don't apply, would you say that was circular? Well, yeah, that's circular. Okay, stay with me. The laws apply because the laws say they apply. Doesn't that sound circular to you? Well, yeah, you're right. It is circular, but it still applies. But you're uncovering the gun in the room, and a guy, you're completely discrediting this man. And I can tell from my experience, they will not even want to consider what this guy said to you. We're not even going to discuss with Mr. So-and-so. We're going to deal with this right now. And in that case, oh, so you agree with your agent, though, if I'm physically in Arizona, the laws apply. Well, yeah, okay, and you're back to square one. Great. Do you have the proof he didn't have? So what I want you to do is we're gonna listen to Nicholas Court. Nicholas Court is a deputy attorney general in New Hampshire. And what I love about New Hampshire, you guys can bring video cameras into the courtroom. So I don't know who actually did. I don't know if it was Perry, Ian couldn't tell me who it was, but somebody videotaped the arguments that I used. I got a screen capture for. So I now have a picture of Nick Court. And his job, again, he has been with the office for decades. He is recognized as an expert, as an authority, not by me, but by, you know, regular people. And he couldn't take more than a few minutes. But I want you to pay attention to the progression and why Nick Court had to hang up on some putts from Long Island. Because as experienced as he is, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what his job is. It doesn't matter how experienced. If you don't have the facts, it doesn't matter. None of that matters. So, yes, we can finally hear this.
Hello, this is Nicholas Court.
Mr. Court, my name is Marc Stevens. I host a radio show. I'd like to be able to ask you a few questions and be able to record for my broadcast. I wanted to ask you some questions regarding the application of New Hampshire state law.
I doubt I'll be able to answer you.
Well, everyone seems to operate under the same presumption that if someone is physically in New Hampshire, then the Constitution and the laws apply. That's not something you're able to speak to?
It's a matter of case law. If you want to look up the cases, that's fine. But I'm not allowed to give legal opinions to anybody except government.
Is your straw man
officials who are authorized to request such opinions?
Well, I'm not asking you for an opinion. What I'd like to know is that since the operating presumption is that if I'm physically in New Hampshire, then the Constitution and laws apply to me, I want to know if there are any actual facts to support that argument.
I have no idea what you're asking me. But, again, I'd say you're definitely asking for a legal opinion.
No, I'm asking for facts. Do you have any actual facts, proof, evidence that would support your legal argument and that of your office and of the governor and whatnot, that if someone is physically in New Hampshire, then the Constitution and laws apply?
It's a matter of case law.
Well,
all you got to do is look at the cases.
But I'm asking you, is there any actual fact? Are there any actual facts? The case law you're talking about are just opinions of other lawyers like yourself.
Those are facts.
Those are facts. So the opinion of...
Opinions issued by courts of law are what determines what the law is.
Well, I understand what the law is. All I'm asking, is there any actual proof that the that just because I'm physically in New Hampshire that the Constitution laws would apply to me?
You're asking a meaningless question.
Meaningless.
The Constitution and laws say that they apply, and because the Constitution and laws were legitimately created, they do apply. So that's the fact, whether you like it or not. And
so let me see if I understand.
I can say.
Your position is the Constitution and laws apply because they say so.
And because of the history behind the Constitution and laws, which make them legitimate.
And the history being that everybody who lives in New Hampshire is forced to pay for the New Hampshire government. Is that the history you're talking about?
No. I'm talking about how the Constitution and laws came into existence.
But you would agree that all the support for the government, people are not asked to pay, people are forced to pay.
They don't have to live in that particular state or that particular country.
Doesn't excuse the violence, to quote a phrase, the violence inherent in the system.
I can't help that.
Just because somebody can leave does not make the forceful taking of their property or the coerced support any less criminal. I mean, I'm sure you would agree that if I was to do business in the same manner as your organization and I forced people to pay me, that I would be a criminal.
Sir, I do not wish to participate in this conversation any further. You are not listening to what I'm saying, and you are expressing opinions and asking me to express opinions, which I am not permitted to do. So, goodbye.
But you don't need to hang up, Nicholas.
So, this is like a lesson in logical fallacies, isn't it? When it's a very common thing that they will phrase your question, or they raise a straw man and call a question of fact an argument, like he just, or asking for legal advice. It technically, in logic, it's called a straw man. I just think it's lying. It's just an effort to avoid answering the question, which is what he did. They can't. So this is what, I urge to, this is why I urge us people to go and do this. There should be thousands of us. The main issue should always be jurisdiction first. Anybody who knows anything about the courts will tell you jurisdiction has to be established first. Did anybody hear anything in that call with the Deputy Attorney General from the New Hampshire Attorney General? Did anybody hear anything resembling facts to support his argument that the laws apply because you're physically in New Hampshire? It would be, I would love to see someone do that to Nick in court. Right? But all right, do we have the microphone? Whoa, somebody lost their phone. Just like the live broadcast, I'm telling you.
We there?
There we go.
Okay, so you chase this down a line, and it sort of dead ends every time for obvious reasons. So if the guy says, it's case law, you say, fine, can you please quote the case law? Well, that's just a judge saying something. That's an opinion. You do have the argument, but you need to force that. He says it's the law, whatever you say. Okay, the law. Oh, you just quoted a law that was just an opinion that was just created out of thin air. So what is behind that law?
Well, you don't even know. You're allowing him to misdirect you. He's not answering the question. If I'm asking, you have your argument. Okay, the argument is very common, no matter where you are. We already have that. You got agreement. If I'm physically in Arizona, then it's X, then Y.
Okay, so what if he says no, what would be the answer that would satisfy you that the Constitution does not apply because it's a corporate construct, it's a fictional construct?
No, it's four pieces of paper.
Right. So it's not something that can be bound to people who weren't even alive when it was written. right?
Nobody signed it, and even if they did, even if everyone signed it, support is coerced. It doesn't matter. The coercion negates all of that.
Right. So what is our payoff here? What is the bottom line?
Well, just like I wrote in Adventures in Legaland, they have two ways that they're doing business. We want them to sacrifice one, okay? They do business with the barrel of a gun. They're willing to kill you or put you in jail to get you to pay them. There's no rational dispute to that. That's it. The other thing is they pretend to be benevolent protectors of life, liberty, and property. The only chance we've always ever had is to make it so that they can't make it look good, is to throw a monkey wrench into the works and bring these out. Now, most of these things still resolve and are pretty good. Like, can we... I want to call that do the other call of shame. This is with the Internal Revenue Service, and this so far has had a good resolution. Again, I'm going through the exact same point. So whether I'm with Nick Court just strictly as a journalist, or I'm engaging the IRS, helping somebody, it's the same thing. And that's why I said if you're doing it out of court as a journalist, you're going to get used to this. You're going to get used to engaging them, all the garbage that they throw at you, and you'll be able to keep a razor-sharp focus. So let's play that IRS call.
Thank you for holding.
Yes.
All right. Looking at the account information, I see a letter was issued out dated around the 18th of August, 2014, notice number CP59, which in relation to income reported to the IRS requests a party to response, verifying if they're not required to file a return with the explanation of reason why they're not filing a return. If they have not filed a return, for which reason the letter was issued, to go ahead and submit the return attached to the copy mm-hmm. of the letter that is sent out, or explanation of why they're not submitting or required to file a return. So basically, this is just an informative letter requesting a response, asking to verify why there is no return that has been filed for the year 2012.
Right, we're calling to get some information before we make a response. I have a question for you. Can you confirm, just yes or no is all I'm looking for, yes or no, can you confirm that there's evidence proving that the Constitution and Code apply to Chris and if there's any jurisdiction over him to require a return?
Yes.
Okay, yes. Just write that down. Okay. What specific facts, then, do you rely on to prove that the Constitution and Code apply to Chris?
Wage and income reported to the IRS.
All right, stop that.
So you're saying the evidence the Constitution applies to him is the fact that information was given to the IRS on the threat
to arrest and coercion. Very important.
Well, the information provided to IRS verifies the W-2 form,
okay.
The taxpayer.
How does forcing someone to give a 1099 or a tax form prove that the Constitution applies to Chris?
Based on income that is reported under the Social Security number, verifies a requirement to file based on the amount of income that is reported to the IRS.
My question is, how does forcing someone to give you a financial report prove the Constitution applies to Chris?
Now, I don't understand when you say forcing someone. Generated for the year 2012. And based on the amount of income that
right.
is reported to the IRS, we're submitting a letter stating we have yet to receive any return. It might be entitled to generating a refund to the party, or it might even generate a balance due. But all we're requesting is, since we have information provided to us under that particular Social Security number, could you respond back by either submitting a return or not submitting a return, explaining why you're not going to file a return?
Yeah, and that's what we're planning on doing, but I want to address your statement that nobody is forcing the information. You do realize on the 7203, people are threatened with jail and prosecution, of course, and severe monetary punishment if they don't provide the information to the IRS.
You don't need to do this part, though.
Forced, so.
What will happen is if we don't get a response, IRS will make a second attempt to get a response. If there's no return posted, the system can use the information that is received and file a substitute return.
I understand that. My question is, what facts? So you're saying the facts that you rely on to prove that the Constitution applies to Chris is because somebody was forced under threat of jail to provide financial information to the IRS, correct?
Nobody was forced to provide information to the IRS. We received documentation from an institution verifying income generated by the party.
Okay, so you're denying the obvious reality that people are forced to under threat of jail to provide the information. So I need you to explain to me how the financial information proves that the Constitution applies to Chris.
Well, I don't want to misguide you. Only thing you have to do is, if there's no requirement to file, response back to the notice. If there's a requirement to file, go ahead, submit a return.
Okay, my question, though, is how is the financial information considered facts proving that the Constitution applies to Chris?
Now, if I receive a W-2 with your name and Social Security number, assumption is it is under your name and Social Security number.
Okay, I love that word, assumption. I understand, but I had asked you if you had evidence to prove with facts. And you said that the facts that prove the Constitution and Code apply to Chris is the financial information that the institution provided. Now, you disagree that it was provided on a threat to arrest and coercion, and we'll deal with that at a later time. You can deny the facts right now, that's fine. It's kind of disingenuous of you. But you need to explain to me how the financial information that was provided to you is somehow proof that the Constitution applies to Chris.
I gotta get my little digs.
As far as tax law, those in-depth information and your, words that you're using, I'm sorry, I cannot really, explain in, what needs to be done by the party. Only thing I can verify is to response to the notice. That's all.
Okay, but maybe you're not. Maybe what? Okay, under 3705 of the Restructuring Act of 1998, you're required to assign an agent with direct.
I had to get that part there, but it's not necessary for the. But I want those three magic words.
We can get
so we have to
call them directly and get this resolved. But I'm not asking you. So that's a request we need to be put in. But I'm not asking you for what Chris should do from this point. I'm asking you just to clarify your statement. Please explain to me, if you can, how the financial information proves the Constitution applies to Chris.
So basically, you want me to answer based on income information that I'm seeing, why is the taxpayer required to file a return?
I didn't ask you that. You said that I asked you three questions. I asked you if you can confirm that there was evidence proving the Constitution and Code applied to Chris and there was jurisdiction to require a return. You said yes. I asked you for the specific facts that you used to prove the Constitution applies to Chris. You said the financial information that was given by the institution. I'm asking you now to clarify that. How exactly does the financial information provided to the IRS under threat, duress, and coercion prove that the Constitution applies to Chris?
I don't know.
Let me write that down. I don't.
There. Now, if you want to hold on and wait, maybe I can get a representative to better clarify the question that you're asking.
You can cut that.
So,
there it is.
Yes.
Keywords. And he kept on saying request. You want facts. They're saying there's a request, but they're not saying it's not a demand. And what you continue to come back to is, why should I do that when it's only a request?
Well,
the fact is that it's the request is a veiled demand.
Well, of course it is.
In some oppression.
It is, but and we'll get you in just a second. And it's available on a website, so anyone can download and you can listen to it. And I have an article that goes with it. There was a little bit of stuff we could have cut out of that. I get that made, but it's better, I think, in this sense, to keep it unedited, because all I did was get his agreement. So you notice that I always got his agreement on his position and then asked him questions. I could have just went right for the throat, and I know that now on hearing it again, where I could have just said, all right, how does the financial information, and I eventually did it, but how does the financial information prove the Constitution applies? Which was just a question based on his statement, his answer, and all you're really doing is following the trivium. You're just asking questions. Kipling, I keep six honest men with me at all times. The names are who, what, where, when, why, and how. And so when you're looking at the trivium, which is just, that's how we learn things, by asking those questions, you'll see that most people probably would have gotten stuck real bad when they're,
We've got the financial information. You ain't income.
How was my question after that? You could use why, but once they make a statement like that, you can go right for the home run there or the knockout punch. How is that true? How does the financial information prove the Constitution? Well, why do we know? Why are we asking that question? Because he was the one that said the financial information were the facts proving the Constitution and code applied. Because the original question was, can you confirm? So she was, do we not? Yeah, we had a microphone. I want to get to, we're going to do the one with the UBC law professor next.
Well, there seems to be a myth that a certain amount of time makes something valid. Nick mentioned it. It's because it's been going on. There's case law. We've been doing this for a long time. This guy kind of played around with that. If you read the evidence code and if you look at Gilbert's evidence code, they both have that myth in there that if something has existed for a long time, it becomes a fact. And so I think that's kind of what they're trying to say to you. Because we've been doing it forever, so it's a fact. Everyone accepts it.
Yes, and that's a typical logical fallacy. It's called an appeal to tradition. So.
And we'll trust it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
I was going to just follow on that, is that, yes, this is the way the legal system in the United States is structured. Other countries structure their things differently. The U.S. is based on case law and opinion. So in every government that is based in a similar fashion, they early on try to establish the lie of their legitimacy. And then if the courts can prevent cases that will actually destroy that myth, that lie, they prevent them from ever reaching the point where the case's legitimacy can be judged. This happens all the time in the United States. The Supreme Court can refuse to hear cases in which they actually go to the root of what the arguments are. And so over time, they essentially establish that if they tell the lie long enough, they can actually later say that this is established case law, and you can no longer bring a case that discusses this because it was either ruled not applicable, you didn't have standing, you know, they came up with reasons. But over time, they establish that, and then they prevent those cases from ever reaching the highest level of the jurisdictional function.
Right.
Okay, so the point is that, that being the case, is there any reason to really try to establish that, take your time and all these other people's time to try to pop their balloon? Because in the end, they're just going to arrest you or imprison you. So isn't it much better to just pop out of the system and just, like a system D, and try to challenge them? Because it's a lot of effort to do what you're doing. Even if you're right, the question is, even if you're right, are you going to make a change to the system?
Well, that's why I mentioned at the beginning that one of the main points, and I actually addressed that fallacy. It's something that I kind of, you know, I may have coined the phrase that it turtles all the way down. I'll explain that in a second. The main point is to get people of doing this is to educate people so that they will stop paying taxes and won't comply with the system. It's not necessarily to go in and get tickets thrown out. Thank goodness at this point in time, there's still some shame and that you can make it look so bad that we are getting a lot of things tossed out. And we have. I mean, I had a guy up in Idaho with felony possession, and at the prelim put the cop on the stand, annihilated him. Even the judge couldn't overlook it. So we have had a lot of things thrown out. So possession and taxes and traffic and stuff like that. So we're not at that point yet where it's don't do anything but lock and load, because your only defense is to use offensive force and start, you know. But the fallacy that you're talking about, and it's very common, I mentioned that before, they'll raise a straw man and say, your argument is frivolous. Hey, I didn't ask you or present you an argument. I asked you a question. Are you literate in English language? I said that to one of the hearing officers in New Hampshire. Is the witness literate in English language? Yeah, then great. I'm asking a question, not presenting an argument. If you don't know the difference, you know, go back to grade school, but that's not my problem at this point. But so what they'll do is, to like what you're saying, I'll come in and I'll say, where is the prosecutor's evidence to prove the Constitution could apply to me, which establishes jurisdiction, which is the burden of proof on the prosecution? The judge will point to another decision. And so I talk about it being its turtles all the way down, because you've got one argument supported by an argument supported by an argument supported by an opinion. I don't care what the hell U.S. versus Romero said. It's an argument. It's an opinion. And every case is fact specific. So what you may have to do with some of these people is, do you actually know the difference between stare decisis and res judicata? If you're talking with a bureaucrat, especially, they'll know what you're talking about, and they'll take great offense to that. Oh, patience, just answer a question, a fact. Okay, we got to be, all right, no, real quick.
I don't need the microphone, I'm pretty well.
People watching it. There we go.
Well, one thing that you've been saying, and I've had a little bit of a problem with, is you keep...
You got a problem?
You talk about the Constitution applying to the people. Well, the Constitution doesn't apply. The Constitution is to govern the government, not to govern the people.
If the Constitution wasn't supposed to apply to the people, then what in the world did they have to do with Article 1, Section 8 that said that Congress had the power to lay and collect taxes? They are applying it to you. Their operating presumption, and you heard, you know, Nick, and we'll hear more, their operating presumption is, whether they have it in the case citation or not, if you're physically in Canada, man, those laws apply to you. They are enforcing their laws on you, and even if you looked at it from that point, the Constitution is the basis that they say for their laws. So they are applying it to you. So we'll listen to another call. Let me introduce it. Again, I've never studied Canadian law. Okay? Never. I've maybe looked up one or two things just out of curiosity. And I spoke to, as a journalist, with a professor of law at the University of British Columbia, Vancouver. This is a law professor. His name was Mr. Blum. And no, they never followed up with me about my complaint. I wanted to know if it was common for Canadian professors to just hang up on Americans. Although I can understand why. I just want to know if it was policy. So this is not a very long call, but it's really good. The University of British Columbia law professor, Mr. Blum.
I'm with the UBC Law School.
Oh, yes. Thanks for calling back. I don't know. Well, I do a radio show, and I was interested.
Yeah.
I think I mentioned that I wanted to be able to ask you some questions, be able to record it for a broadcast.
And which radio show do you do?
It's called the No State Project.
What's it called? The No State?
No State Project.
Okay. And where are you?
Well, I'm in Phoenix, Arizona.
Oh, okay. So, can you just sort of explain the general nature of what you wanted to talk about?
Well, I help a lot of people all over the U.S., Canada, Australia, New Zealand, and England, and resolve problems with bureaucrats and politicians attacking them, you know, tax stuff, things like that. And I've noticed that the general operating presumption, and I've had this confirmed many times, the last one in Canada was the spokesman for the Attorney General's office in Toronto, that if someone is physically in Canada, then the laws of Canada apply to them. Now, would you agree with that?
It all depends on what the issue is. I mean, if they're physically in Canada, yes, the criminal laws of Canada apply to them.
So,
because they're...
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, what were we going to say?
No, but it all depends. In private law matters, it's a bit trickier because you can be in Canada but make a contract under New York law. But if you're in Canada and the question is what law do you need to obey on the road and so on, well, then there's no question that it's Canadian law.
Right, so I've gotten confirmation that if I'm in Canada, if I'm physically in Canada, then the laws of Canada apply to me. And the issue that I have is that
no one's been able to give me any actual evidence to prove that just because I'm physically in Canada, then that Canadian laws apply. So what would let me ask you, what evidence, if any, would you be able to show that just because I was physically in Canada, that the Canadian law would apply to me?
Well, because that's the Canadian rule and that's the international rule.
That's the rule.
Yeah.
But that still begs the question, what evidence is there that that rule actually applies? I know that usually they break it down into ordinances or statutes or code, whatever. Still begs the question, what evidence is there that the Constitution, let's say the laws of Canada apply to me just because I'm in Canada? And you're saying, that's the rule. But what actual evidence is there beyond saying that's the rule?
Well, it's not a matter of evidence. It's if a legal question comes up before some authority in Canada, they have to obey Canadian law, and Canadian law says Canadian law applies to anybody in Canada.
So you're of the same opinion then so many other politicians and bureaucrats are, that the law applies because the law says so.
That's the way the law works.
Okay. Let me just write that down. See, just like I tell tax agents, that's not actually evidence. That's just a circular logic. That's a logical fallacy.
No, I'm sorry. I've had these discussions with other people, and they go nowhere. If you don't buy the proposition that the law decides when the law decides, then there's no higher authority to appeal to.
The law decides when the law decides?
Yeah, when the law applies.
So how is it not a logical fallacy, being circular logic, to say that the law applies because the law says so?
Well, because it applies as far as who's concerned. I mean, if you're saying it's not in the nature of things for the law to apply, who cares? I mean, the question is, what law is somebody going to apply if you get in front of a court? I mean, if you want to argue I kind of know the argument that somehow that there is nothing inherent in law that makes it binding on people. Well, that you can philosophize about that, but human society is based upon the idea that law applies when the law says that it applies and when the authorities apply it.
Well, there's a lot going on there. It's not a matter of philosophy. It's a matter of...
I'm sorry. I'm not interested in pursuing this discussion. Goodbye.
Oh, you don't have to hang up.
I know. You don't have to hang up. Well, what happens is on Skype, once they hang up, it cuts the recording, period. I mean, so there's nothing else there, Unless I'm on with the IRS and they hang up, then it's still a three-way call. And I've got to, like Chris, I have him on. I know I'm pretty much out of time. So I want to just summarize and then take some questions. I think can you see and understand why it would be so effective to just ask these simple questions? I mean, imagine if you are attacked later. And you have these calls, or you've heard that they don't have the evidence. Because I've done this with police chiefs, and I recommend that people in Scottsdale say, I don't know where this cop is, because the police chief doesn't have a clue. And if the chief doesn't, and he's been on this force for 30 years. But these are things that we can use later. But you see how calls like that should at least get people questioning, why couldn't he answer the question directly? Just at least get people thinking. But... And the other side, too, it's very effective when you're engaging them, you recognize the logical fallacies, so that when you are attacked, when you raise the same issues in court, you know what to expect. You're going to know how to address that. It doesn't mean they're always going to do the right thing, because they don't. But at least it gives us something that you're able to stand up for yourself and not have to spend tens of thousands of dollars on an attorney who's just going to shaft you anyway, which happens all too often. So... you have the mic?
Yeah, I just want to go back to the point. You're challenging these people to say, where are the facts? And you say, what is the constitutional connection? How does the Constitution give you the authority to obligate these people under force and threat?
No, that's not.
No?
Their operating presumption is wherever they may be, whether you call it constitution or law, it doesn't matter. If you're physically in area X, then the laws of X apply to you. And that's how
so
I...
So that's not a constitutional authority. That's some other authority.
Where it's not... You see, that's a very common fallacy that they throw. Well, Marc, if you want to challenge the constitutionality... Whoa. No. It's an issue of fact. When you talk about constitutionality, that's an issue of law. They're two total, separate, completely different things.
Are you getting these to the point where a constitution is just a piece of paper, therefore it cannot bind me to your authority?
I don't need to bring that out. I mean, I used to go in and lay it out and say, do you know what this is? No. Then how can you prove it applies to me? It's just over the years you start learning after engaging thousands of these people that what's more effective and what's not. And so you want to keep distilling it down until it's as easy as possible. I mean, I think that the easiest thing for now, and it may change in 6 months, I don't know how it could possibly get simpler, but I probably said that before. If you stick to just the observable facts and the argument that they're coming at you with, that is always the same thing. The foundational argument is always exactly the same. I don't care where you are. We just heard Canada. We have others on the website that you can go into other parts of Canada, England, and Australia. It doesn't matter. It's an issue of fact that we want to know what evidence they have to support that argument, because all the other arguments that they have that they're using against you are on that foundation. They'll even tell you, if there's no evidence of jurisdiction, does it matter what? Well, no, because that's the foundation. So we talk about striking the root. It makes no sense because you're in damage control if you're actually in court. I have a few minutes to do this. I have to stop these people from attacking me. I've got to make it count. Go right at the foundation of the attack, because none of that, who cares if I'm growing poppy in my backyard? And I mean the Afghan type, okay? Who cares if there's no evidence that the agent coming after me has to support his argument that his laws apply because I'm physically in Arizona?
And this phone call ended like some of them do, where, oh, he's just a kook, goodbye, hanging up. So what's the win? You know, how do you make this work for you? How do you make this take effect on your cases?
Well, I want to preface this first by saying the win comes in because people contact me all the time that they're not paying taxes anymore. That, to me, is the single most – that I want to hear. I want to hear people saying, man, I'm not paying taxes anymore. Screw this. I quit my job. No license. Screw. That's the main object, is to give people tools to be able to live their lives with more autonomy. As far as the tickets, the payoff generally comes because they can't make it look good anymore, because they actually impeach their own witness, which I've spoken about many times, to where you're going to get the judge to contradict himself. He's going to allow the witness to testify that there is evidence in his that he has personal knowledge of, proving the Constitution and code apply. They have to put the cop on the stand to try to make it look good. So you'll object on grounds he doesn't have personal first-hand knowledge. So for those who don't know the evidence code, to be a witness, you have to actually witness something, which means personal first-hand knowledge. It's time for you to do a cross-examination. You will purposely ask him certain questions regarding jurisdiction, the application of the code. Even though they are questions of fact, the prosecution can't resist. He'll jump up with the judge and actually impeach his own witness. And that's where a lot of these things are tossed out. A lot of them are tossed out because the judge is now in a pretty tight bind. Is the witness competent or not? It has nothing to do with your political philosophy or if you're an anarchist. It doesn't matter. The judge is now in a pretty tight bind. He just said the witness was competent. Now the prosecutor is saying he's incompetent. We don't even have to get into the fact that the prosecutor is a lying snake who just committed a felony. We just have to address the issue, is the witness competent or not? Because the judge will reflexively say, motion sustained. Really? So you want to clarify. It's the Socratic method. Did you just say the witness was not qualified to give legal opinions? Well, strike them from the record then, including the one on the ticket. You don't have a witness who's qualified by your own admission, sir, to say that I violated the law. They do it almost every time. This show could be broadcast on every major station. 1 billion people could watch it. You'd still go into traffic court, and they would still do it.
Lack of evidence.
Yeah.
Challenge the evidence, and if you can't produce it, identify what evidence exactly, but they will generally give a general statement that we're dismissing the case for lack of evidence. That's
the police's verbal claim is evidence.
They'll say that initially. But you have to question them. You can't just take them at their word. So what I tell people, there's two very simple things you have to understand when you're talking with bureaucrats, especially if they're attacking you. Everything they say is a lie. If it resembles the truth, it's not relevant. And if you examine their attack, you'll see that play out time and time and time again. Was the evidence, which was true, let's say they had financial information, was it actually relevant at all to proving the Constitution applied and there was jurisdiction? No. So, everything is a lie. If it resembles the truth, it's irrelevant. It's got nothing to do with supporting their argument. Absolutely nothing. I've gone in many times. I'm like, yeah, of course we have. We'll cut you a check right now if you can provide the evidence. But they don't have it. So, it's not an issue I've never said, and anyone who does claim is just flat out misleading you. Just because you absolutely annihilate and destroy their position does not mean for a second it's going to get tossed out. Someone in Alaska, I watched him. Yes, his delivery wasn't very good, but he annihilated these witnesses. He had an IRS superstar witness on the stand yelling at him, saying, and this is a direct quote, "I resent you, sir. I resent people like you." I'm like, oh, whoa. The jury loved this woman, but she lost her mind. And, do you think that resentment may have tainted your testimony today? A little bit. He was able to show, because a lot of what you're doing is uncovering a gun in the room. He said to the witness, each witness that wasn't from the IRS, okay, because they are there because it's part of their job, looked the witness, and said, "Who forced you to testify against me today?" I'm not being forced, I'm testifying freely. I'm confused. Aren't you on a subpoena? Could you please explain to me how you can freely testify under subpoena? Now, I don't know if everyone here is putting two to two together. Like, my gosh, the witnesses each said that. Each time was a separate count of perjury. They lied through their teeth. He actually asked these witnesses, "Are you afraid of the IRS?" No. Perjury. So even all that, yes, the judge did go and talk to the jury after he charged them. They convicted him in less than an hour. The fix was in. So I would say that every time if you ask questions, you're always going to uncover that it's a rigged game, that they're scammers. In fact, what I wrote down, I'm glad I remember to do this. If you watch the video where I helped Ian Freeman of Free Talk Live and of the network I'm on, LRN.FM, the psychopath Michael King actually shouts, "I don't need evidence. I have a statute." To which I said, "Well, objection. The prosecution hasn't presented a single fact to prove it actually applies to Ian." And he lost. They cut my transmission, sort of like what they call the shame, and that's how you deal with it. "Oh, I don't have any evidence. F." Cut the transmission. That's what they do. So, were there any more questions? Yeah.
So, I'm just curious. Have you or anyone else you know of taken this tack? The person stands up in front of the judge and says, "I'm here under subpoena. I'm not here on my own free will. I'm here under duress. And I'm here because of one of two situations. And I'd like to know, sir, which one it is. One, am I being compelled to be here to perform on a contract, or am I here to be called as property?"
No, I've not encountered anyone that's done that. Well, we mentioned the threat, duress, and coercion. Whenever we file the documents with the motions templates I have available, it says right at the top that I'm participating on a threat, duress, and coercion.
Right.
But not in the manner that you're saying, no.
But you see where I'm going here. If I'm here to perform under a contract, then they'd have to show evidence of a contract. But they're really acting as if I'm property.
Yes. They won't admit that. I still did. Well, was she first?
Okay, well, she had.
I was just wondering,
wondering why you pay your property taxes.
I rent.
You still pay them?
It's probably still being taken out of that, yeah. Property taxes are very... You know, I've helped a number of people, and most people don't want to follow through on it because it's not like the IRS will take a bank account or they'll garnish a wage. They'll actually take your house. But I am working with somebody who is trying to get it back, not the house, the money. And so what he's done is he filed a claim against the county's risk management, their insurance policy. There is no immunity. And so the evidence that we have is overwhelming because I was on the calls, he did the calls, we have it in writing. They openly admitted to not having a shred of evidence to prove jurisdiction, but they took the money anyway. So I'm pretty confident that he can, you know, he'll be able to establish that there's clearly no jurisdiction, I mean, because he's got their own admissions. He's got their attorneys on record that there's no evidence. So I think he's going to, you know, he stands a pretty good chance. I personally wouldn't take these things into court. I like, again, New Hampshire, they have an administrative process when you go against the insurance claim, when you take an insurance claim. You don't have to actually go to court first, which is nice.
In answer to the previous gentleman's question, why am I here, under what circumstance, it's actually in the contract. It's called the location contract. This is a contract that the government essentially says you are bound to, whether or not you ever signed it, and we will enforce it with force. Okay.
Well,
this is how most of the laws apply in our country and in many other countries. It's an adhesion.
But where are you getting the phrase adhesion contract? Is it from those who are actually doing the attack, or is that just something?
I'm not sure.
There you go. That's what I was looking for. But in my limited time, we could talk a lot more about this stuff on the show because we're doing a live broadcast right here, the Acton Room, just on the other side, 3 hours that we can do, you know, we can finish this. I believe it's much more effective instead of assuming that they are trying to hit you with an adhesion contract, because that would be like saying that, Benny Blanco from the Bronx, you know, was actually contracting with you. Was that too obscure a reference? Okay, Al Capone, when he sold beer in 1925, that he was trying to contract with you. It's not in the, you know, I think it's much better to just take the arguments that they're presenting to you and just start tearing them to shreds. Because then, because what you're doing there is taking a burden on yourself. You may actually be right. But do you want to take a burden on yourself and take the attention away from the attacker?
Well, I'm just presenting the view of the government that there is a contract that they say that they can enforce, whether or not there's any legitimacy.
But are they actually alleging that, though?
Yes, I understand.
Where are they?
Exactly, there's no evidence.
They're not actually alleging that.
No.
They're not.
It's really more of a retort, I think.
Okay,
so,
yeah. Right. Yeah, I agree. Yeah, I believe that the people should. That I don't think there's any moral responsibility for somebody when they're forced under threat, duress, and coercion to participate in the jury to be completely upfront and honest about their beliefs to the psychopath who's doing that. I mean, I got to tell you, I mentioned this on the show. It's really surreal when you understand and you've been at a point where you can strip out all the political garbage and actually go watch a jury being selected. And have the judge just laughing, you know, making jokes. There was a woman who said that she had vertigo. Well, we have buckets. Like, and he's laughing, funny. I'm like, it's like I'm in a Twilight Zone. You're committing, at this point in time, Mr. Judge, Beastline, you are committing 58 separate felonies right now. Violent felonies. The fact that these people showed up and sat down doesn't make it any less violent. It was keeping 58 people or so or more, it false imprisonment. It's assault to get them in there. It's threatening. It's false imprisonment to keep them there. These are felonies. He's doing it every day without a clue. And if he does, he doesn't give a damn. He didn't care. whatever. And to be able to laugh about it. That's why I can't forget that stupid joke, because this woman's complaining about vertigo. She could fall and split her head open. He's making jokes. Man, we got buckets here. Well, yeah, you need buckets here because all the crap that you... Do we have any more questions? The live broadcast is going to be in the Acton room. It's right next to the Brittany room. It's to the left of the Brittany room. Okay. So before, it's right over there. It's from one to four. Yes, 1 to 4. All right. Well, I appreciate everyone coming out here to Libertopia. Thank you. We have a few books available, a couple of shirts, and please, the website is markstevens.net, and join us. Please, everybody, welcome. Join us for the live broadcast.